So I'm glad to pass the floor to Alex to give us his presentation. Thank you, Alex.
Good morning, all colleagues from Russia, and I'm very happy to meet again some of you, some years without having the chance to meet you again. And thank you so much, obviously, Ivan, for your welcoming words, both in Russian and in English. And it's always a pleasure to hear that amazing things from your lovely country. So my idea today is to share with you some of the elements that have made possible our sudden transformation to a new learning model, that is based on the combination of methodology, of technology, and also of many different psychological elements that are also in play during this context. So just to start it up, I am going to share with you my screen because I have prepared a presentation that obviously it's going to be available for you after this session. So and as Ivan mentioned before, you are also going to receive the recording. So do not worry about nothing, because everything is going to be sent to you after it. Just to keep the session in a proper way, please mute your microphones. Please, whatever you need or whatever you want to ask, you have the chat there in the upper right corner of this of the screen of Google Meet. Is the chat, so you can write whatever you want there. And please, whatever you need, just write us an email with anything. Ivan, yeah. You want Alex, to say something,
yes,
right?
Yes, before we proceed to the webinar itself, I would like to give a floor for welcoming for representative of Erasmus Plus office in Russia, to Anna Viktorova. She's with us. Anna, if you can hear me, can give some welcoming words to participants in English or in Russian, it will be very welcome.
Да, добрый день. Несколько слов от нашего офиса. Добрый день, уважаемые коллеги. Приветствую вас от имени национального офиса Erasmus+. К сожалению, наша руководитель Ольга Николаевна Олейникова сегодня по техническим причинам не смогла присоединиться, но передает вам всем пожелания, наилучшие пожелания. Сегодня мы начинаем цикл вебинаров совместно с университетом Деусто, с которым мы сотрудничаем долгое время. Многие из вас помнят проекты Tempus, Tuning, которые оказали очень большое влияние на систему высшего образования России. И сегодня наша совместная инициатива является таким вызовом в сложных условиях. И надеемся, что он будет успешным. Мы благодарим коллег из университета Деусто, которые занимались организацией данного вебинара, Ивана Дюкарева, конечно же, Алекса Райана, проректора университета, который любезно согласился провести этот вебинар. Также, пользуясь случаем, мы хотим поздравить всех с наступающим праздником Великой Победы. Берегите себя и своих близких. Самое главное, будьте здоровы. Спасибо большое. Всем удачного вебинара.
Спасибо, Анна. Коллеги, еще раз, иногда появляется, что кто-то пытается делать презентацию, вы, по-видимому, по ошибке нажимаете на кнопки. Пожалуйста, не трогайте ваши окна Google Meet, потому что во время презентации, которая будет записана, если будет ваша появляться какая-то презентация, это будет прерываться презентация. Поэтому огромное спасибо, чтобы вы не пытались трогать ничего в вашем компьютере. Okay, so we will thank you very much, Anna, and we are now ready for the presentation of Alex Rayón. Please, Alex, thank you.
Okay, thank you so much again. And as I mentioned before, please do not click on your screen sharing, okay? Because with just to keep the presentation only on my screen, I need to have this this option only for myself. Okay, so on the low right part of the screen, where you have a button that is that says to share your screen, please do not touch nothing there. Okay, thank you, Spasiba. So as I was saying before, we are going to go through all the details that we think at the University of Deusto are needed to consider in this extremely extraordinary situation that we are facing. Okay, you know that higher education is a really complex issue. We do have many different elements when we teach online. We are speaking these days about how to teach online, but that's not enough. Because, for example, what about the learning contents? What about the learning materials? What happens with all those materials that we have prepared for a traditional face-to-face class, and that when we teach it online, it is not enough. We do need to transform ourselves. Okay, we do need to transform also how we teach. Okay, so I am going to use many times the word to transform, because I think that during these first weeks of the coronavirus outbreak, what we have done is just to digitalize our course. I mean, we have taken the course that was designed for the traditional face-to-face class and we have brought it to our virtual platform that we all have at our disposal at our universities. But we need to make more transformations. And that's my idea with this webinar, to go through all the details that I think we need to change. And these are the, at least from my humble point of view, the five most important elements to consider. First of all, I am going to speak about the learning methodology. Here at the University of Deusto, we have created a new remote attendance learning model. I mean, the methodology that is giving the name to this webinar. I am going to speak about technology. Fortunately, many different technological vendors have opened for free for educators many very powerful tools. So I think that we also have the chance to take advantage of these amazing tools. I'm going to speak about how to engage with our students in a new environment. Obviously, it's not the same to engage with our students when we are facing face-to-face classes compared to an online environment where we do not have the eye contact, for example. Obviously, we have to discuss also the student workload, because again, we designed a course that was supposed to be delivered in traditional face-to-face classes. So all the workload was designed to a different setup, to a different environment. So we need to also transform how we teach that course regarding to the student workload. And finally, we are going to speak also around the assessment that is, at least for me, the most complex issue. I must confess you that we need to think on it again, because I think that we are having challenging times in order to control the identity of our students, to try to prevent the cheating aspects of any exam. So I think that we have some problems there. So let's go through all these five elements. I'm going to spend like 45 minutes going through all these elements, and we are going to share with you, with all our Russian colleagues, all the things that we know. I am going to provide you many different scientific articles that we have been working on during these last weeks to adapt our learning methodologies at the University of Deusto. So after that, you are going to be also available to ask for any of the issues that I have been mentioning. So this is the overview of the methodology that we have created at the University of Deusto. In online environments, we do have to make a difference between the two main approaches that we have. First of all, we have to speak about the synchronous activities. This is a synchronous activity because we are meeting in a specific time, in a specific place, and you are going to be also making some questions after this webinar. So this is the traditional setting of a synchronous online session. The problem is that some of the traditional elements that are at stake in a regular class in online environments do not work. For example, what about how our students are paying attention? Obviously, a screen is not the best way to motivate our students. So the maximum time that is recommended by many different authors in an online environment is 1 hour. Are we ready? Are our universities ready to only have lecturing for 1 hour synchronously? If we are ready for that, we should think in preparing pre-work activities and post-work activities. I mean, we need to transform our courses for both synchronous and asynchronous activities and adapt also the contents for that purpose. Okay. For example, here we recommend to you to only spend like half of the course in synchronous sessions and spend the rest 50% in pre-work activities. For example, in my case, I teach big data analytics, algorithms, and so on. For that purposes, I usually record myself in my computer explaining some of the algorithms, and those recordings that do not need the interaction with my students, I share them with my students prior to the classes, where we have practical activities in synchronous way. Why in synchronous sessions? Because my students are able to ask me for any question that they may have. So as you see, we need to change perhaps how we define some activities and how we order them. Okay, so I propose you to design some activities in kind of pre-work asynchronous sessions. After that, we can have the synchronous lessons. And after that, just as a continuity of these synchronous lessons, I usually ask my students to keep practicing some of the activities, and I supervise their work in the forum, in the chat, or wherever it is. But that's kind of a continuation of the lessons that we have had before in synchronous mode. So as you see, we recommend to you to split the time in two different approaches, synchronous and asynchronous one, and we recommend to you to take different learning modalities, take different technologies in order to help them out with these two approaches. Okay, both of them have some advantages and disadvantages. The main advantage of a synchronous teaching activity is that our students are going to be able to ask us about anything that they aren't understanding. But we do have a very big disadvantage. You know that the universities were created to share education at the same level for anyone. That's the origin of the term university, for all. The problem is that when we are at home, some of you may have your children at home, some others may have a huge noise, some others may have their dad or mom at home working. So the context is very different. So the problem with the synchronous lessons is that our students are not at the same level. So we cannot only give the chance to follow the classes in synchronous way, because otherwise we are generating disparities and we are generating disadvantages between the students that do not have the same, even the same internet connection. So that's why we recommend to you to record all the lessons, such as we are doing in this session, and we recommend to you to complement that synchronous activities with other asynchronous activities. Okay, and in that way, we are balancing all the resources and we are giving our students the opportunity to repeat the classes as many times as they want, because everything has been recorded. So as everything has been recorded, it can be played as many times as they want. Okay, so that's why, for example, for synchronous learning, I do use this audio and video conferencing activities with my students. I use the shared whiteboard. I am going to explain to you some of the whiteboards that we have available on the internet for free to draw and to write as if we were at class. I usually also organize some activities of joint viewing of some multimedia presentations. So as you see, I mix up many different learning activities, such as the examples that I am going to share with you afterwards. And what about asynchronous learning? As I said before, for me, the main benefit of the asynchronous learning is that our students are going to be available even though they do not have proper connection at home. So, for example, in my case, I love forums. I love a place on the virtual platform where I propose some questions to my students, and they are able to make other questions to ask me about it and so on. It's a very easy tool, but a very efficient tool also, because it works quite easily without any fast connection. Okay, so for all that purposes, I think that the new role that we should adopt is we need to be instructional designers. I mean, this article, I found this article the other day in my favorite higher education newspaper, and I strongly agree with the author of that article. For me, our hottest role right now is to be instructional designers. I mean, we need to design again our courses for online settings, because at least from my humble point of view, this crisis is going to bring us a new opportunities to reach new audiences, to offer new education to our students, and finally to collaborate even with new institutions all over the world, because we can go farther than what we were doing before, because we can take advantage of all these technologies and all these methodologies to offer new opportunities to our students. So that's why, for me at least, the most important thing is both the methodology and the that instructional design that we should be doing as professors, as teachers, in these new online environments. But all those things do need technology. And that's why I'm going to share with you some of the tools that I know, that I use in my everyday life, and that I know that they work very well. Okay? For example, Jamboard. Jamboard is a tool that is available for free. Okay? Jamboard.google.com. Do not worry, because in the slides that we are going to share with you later on, you are going to find the links to all these tools. As you see here, I use this tool every day with all my students and even with my colleagues, because I love writing and I love to share my screen with my students to explain complex issues. And as you see, this is a collaborative tool, okay, where I can write as if I were at class, but my students are also able to join this whiteboard. For example, if I share this whiteboard with my colleague, Ivan Bukarev, okay, Ivan is going to be able to join this shared whiteboard, and he can join me here writing whatever it is. So I can share this whiteboard with my students, and they are going to be able to join me and write here whatever they want. And the best utility of these tools is that, as you see here, I have as much whiteboards as I want, and all this is being recorded. So my students are going to be able to repeat this class if they want, okay? And my students are going to be able to follow again the explanations that were given at class, okay? So this is why I love Jamboard, or also Tweetlab. Tweetlab is another whiteboard tool that is also collaborative and is also available for free on the internet, okay? Apart from that, I also use this tool. This tool is called Loom. Okay, you see that in the low left part of my screen, it appears my camera. Okay, and this tool permits me to record my screen while I am explaining something. So this is the tool that I use for recording myself explaining whatever it is. Okay, let's suppose that I am explaining how to develop an algorithm, or let's suppose that I am explaining any psychology, therapy, or whatever it is. And the tool is recording myself while I am drawing, I am explaining, and when I want to end up that recording, this tool that is available for free for educators all over the world is going to upload this video to the cloud. Okay, and as you see there, quite easily, this video has been recorded and it has been uploaded to a cloud on the internet, and I can share this video to my students just clicking on 2-3 buttons. Okay, so as you see, it's very easy to adapt your contents to this new reality that we are facing. Apart from that, I also use YouTube Studio with to edit my videos. YouTube Studio is also a free tool available for educators. It's in a tool that is called YouTube Academy, because YouTube also has some tools for educators, and I use that tool to cut the videos or to introduce other pieces of videos that I found them on the internet. Apart from that, I also use Perusal, that is a social e-reading tool. Okay, I mean, this is a tool that, for example, is quite interesting for professors that maybe hear from law, because in law schools you are quite used to discuss around some written documents where you could be interested in discussing some ideas around that written document, and you can do it in a collaborative way, and we can do it in a peer reviewing way. Okay, so we can share all the conclusions with our students. I also use PowerPoint recording, because PowerPoint also has a tool such as Loom to record yourself while you are describing some context, but while you are using the PowerPoint tool. So as you see there, we also have the opportunity to record ourselves explaining something on the computer and to share those resources with our students in a synchronous way. Okay, so as you will find in my Loom website, I do have many videos here explaining many things, because I love recording myself explaining things. Okay, so this is my collection of videos where I am explaining how to solve mathematical problems, engineering problems, and so on with all my students. Okay, so as you see, we have many tools, and I strongly recommend to you to take a look to these resources, because as you see, Loom has been open for free for educators. You have as much space as you want to upload videos. You know that videos are quite heavy, so if you start recording them and sharing them and saving them in your computer, in your hard disk, you are going to fool it quite easily. So there are many tools on the cloud, on the internet, so just take a look to them. But the video recording is not it's not an easy step, okay? Because we have a huge evidence on the internet, on the literature, to know that, for example, long videos are not the best tool to educate, because our students lose the attention quite fast. We know that how we explain things in a video is not the same as if we were at class, because this new way of communication, that is this video and audio resources, do have different contexts, do have different records, do have different codes of communication. So we need to learn on how to record ourselves in front of the camera. So we professors need to develop new skills, especially on communication, because, and as in this paper that I recommend to you to take a look to it, the authors propose, we need to learn on how to make effective instructional videos, because it is a very tricky issue. And even the duration of the video, the length of the video, it's not an easy decision. In this paper, the authors made an experiment comparing students that were exposed to a long video of 60 minutes compared to a group of students that were exposed to 12 videos of 5 minutes. Apparently, the duration is the same one, 60 minutes versus 12 videos of 5 minutes. So students learn from different videos, but the duration was the same. But the authors found that the students learn better when they are exposed to short videos. So perhaps we should consider to start to be also instructional video designers. I mean, we need to design the content of 5-minute videos explaining our knowledge to our students, and to make a proper design to record different short videos where our students can learn complex issues, but in different segments. I mean, in different small chunks of videos that is easier to explain to our students whatever it is. So Videos must be short, must be very, very dynamic. We need to be all the time with our energy in hand. Consider using this kind of headsets, because these headsets reduce the latency in the communications. That's why the best way to have an online conversation is always with this kind of with headsets in hands. Consider the disability compliance. We also have students that perhaps are deaf or blind, or do have some difficulties to understand this new audiovisual communication. So that's why, for example, I love YouTube, because YouTube automatically brings captioning to the videos, integrate the interaction in the lecturing. For example, in my case, it's very strange to have 60 minutes class without introducing a short video, a short questionnaire, a short exercise, because it's much more difficult to maintain the attention in these environments. Okay, so here you will find all these resources that I have been explaining before, but match it to all the methodologies. For example, Twitla, that online whiteboard that I was explaining before. Discord, that is a tool to organize group work. Okay, this is again a free tool that has been open for free for professors. For example, in a traditional class, when we want to make 10 groups of 4 people to prepare some activity, some exercise, it's quite easy. We split the class in different groups, and we, as professors, go through the different groups supervising how they are executing the task. Discord will permit you to organize your class in different groups and to be able to move yourself around those rooms and to be helping your students with all the different elements that they may need. Okay, so as you see, we have many tools available for us. And even for remote help that our students may need. AnyDesk is a free tool that, again, has been open for free during this coronavirus outbreak that will permit you to take the remote control of a computer. For example, I use this tool when I want to solve a problem that our students or any of my students is having, and I do not understand something because I am not really seeing what is happening in his or her computer. And that's why in those cases, I use AnyDesk to take the remote control of a computer that is on the other side of the connection on the internet. So as you see, many tools, many free tools, many available tools that we need to match with that methodology that I explained before. So as I said at the starting, I think that it's we have a huge opportunity to transform how we teach online. We have a huge opportunity to deliver quality education also on these online workshops. And also we have a huge opportunity to provide our students with the best education that they may have for our future societies. So we have already covered the methodological aspects. We have already gone through the technology that is available for us, and we do not need we do need to also pay attention to these motivational and psychological elements that are also at stake during this pandemic, because obviously that our students are starting to feel alone. Okay, in this paper, these authors discuss the psychological situation that our students face when they learn in remote mode. I mean, it's not the same. When we go to class, we do have the social interaction that permits us to discuss, to know more about our colleagues, to know more about their personal life. But what happens now? We do not have the possibility for that social interaction. So we need to be also community manager. We need to generate new opportunities to interact with our students. We need to offer those social spaces to provide our students the opportunity to interact with their colleagues. And that's why I also think that we need to adopt a new role on our profession, on our job as professors. We need to adopt the communication role as community generators, and we need to be very active into offer our students the opportunity to interact with other ones. Okay, so that's why in this paper I found some evidences on how to generate that interaction between the students, between the faculty and the students, and also in how to encourage the social discussion that is very important to provide our students that social feeling that is very important also to provide the background, the proper background to learn, to study, okay? Because otherwise they are going to feel alone, they are going to feel isolated, they are going to feel frustrated, and they are going to lose the engagement that they usually have to study and to learn, okay? And that's why, for example, in my case, I organize many different group work activities, for example, with the tool that I was explaining before, that Discord tool, a tool where I organize different group work activities. I do post many different messages on the forum because I want to provoke that social interaction that our students need. And as I said before, I feel many days that I am kind of a dynamic professor that is all the time chasing that interaction between our students. Okay, so as you see, I have transformed my job as a professor to many different things that I am mixing up to also offer our students that opportunity to interact. But do not never forget that we are facing a huge stress also in terms of the network infrastructure. Okay, I am not familiar obviously with how is the situation being in Russia, but here in Spain, in Europe in general, we are facing many problems regarding to the internet, and that's why I usually propose group work activities also in a synchronous way, okay? Because in that way, our students are going to find that social interaction also without depending on the live connection on the internet, okay? And that's why we also need to take into consideration the network overload. We need to take into consideration that our students learn better if they collaborate. So we need to propose group work activities to our students where they need to find and to develop those skills that are needed to find group decisions, for example, and we need to develop within our students the need to listen to others, to take into consideration the opinions from different people, and to generate that group work feeling that is always at a stake in this kind of environments. Okay, so as you see, we are facing new problems. We do need to do new things, and as you see, we need to adapt and to transform our work, because the problems are new for us. We weren't trained for these problems. So that's why I think that we are facing a historic moment in terms of the role that professors are going to be developing in the future. We do need to think all the time in the workload of our students, because if they feel that we are offering them many different choices, many different activities, they are going to start feeling quite frustrated. We are also isolated. So, for example, here at the University of Deusto, we are organizing webinars such as this one for all the professors at the University of Deusto, because we need to also generate that community feeling among our students, our professors, because our professors are also alone at home. So we need to generate that community also with our professors. Indeed, for example, in our case, we have created a social network where our professors are writing their challenges, their problems, and all the things that they need to solve in order to deliver a proper online session. So new problems that need new solutions in order to develop quality workshops and quality classes over the internet. So just to end up this online workshop, we are going to speak about the, first of all, the student workload, and finally about the assessment. And with those five elements, we are going to end up these challenging times, at least thinking on in all the elements that we need to consider to transform our identity as professors. So what about the student workload? I do not know if you have also transformed your course regarding the workload from the traditional contact hours. When we are at traditional face-to-face classes, it's very easy to ask for us to manage the workload, because we go to class and we start organizing everything. We say, for example, on Mondays, this week we are going to have 3 contact hours and we are going to do this thing and this another thing. But what happens in online environments? We need to communicate with our students in order to explain them that we are going to have some contact hours by synchronous online sessions, but they do need to develop the independent work by themselves and maintaining the scheduling that they are supposed to maintain. So the student workload is more important than ever if we want to offer them a proper guide to learn all the things that they are supposed to be learning. Some days I think that, and I find myself taking the role of a tourist guide. You know that the tourist guides organize all the micro details of all the things that the tourists are supposed to be doing while they are in a holiday travel in Moscow, in St. Petersburg, or wherever it is. So you know that in those trips, we receive a guide where we know all the details of all the things that we are going to be doing on during the mornings, during the afternoons, or whatever it is. So that's my role here. I take the role of being a tourist guide, where I offer my students a scheduling such as this one, where I explain them the competence that they are supposed to be developing, the activities that they are going to be developing, the documentation that they need to consider, the type of activity that they are going to be doing, how much time they are supposed to be taking for doing that activity, and the starting day and end day of that activity. So as you see, a comprehensive student workload, a work plan where our students know the expectations about what they are supposed to be developing, and our students are going to be also able to plan themselves and to plan all the activities that they are supposed to be doing during that week. Okay, so that's why, for example, in my case, I organize my courses in this way. Okay, I provide them the dates, the assignments that they are supposed to be doing during that week. I provide the due dates for all the activities. I also provide them multiple opportunities to solve any activity. Because as I said before, we are supposing all the time that our students are very competent in terms of the digital world. But I would doubt if I were you regarding that point, because not all of our students do dominate this digital world as other students. So if we provide and we propose them an activity that is very dependent of, for example, any digital tool, we could be limiting the way that they can execute and develop some activity. So that's why, for example, in my case, I provide them many different ways of solving any problem, because in that way I am avoiding the digital limitations that many tools have. And that's why I make inclusive exercise proposals in the way that they are going to be very very open. I am going to be very diversive in terms of how they can solve that problem. And obviously, I also give credit to them for all the activities and all the participation that they could be doing in online activities. For example, in the forums, in those spaces where in those social networks where professors and students are meeting and where we are discussing all the contents of the subject. I grade them. I give credit them to them if they take part in that conversation and if they provide and if they make proper questions, if they answer to other students. So as you see, I also evaluate other learning outcomes that our students could be developing due to this new digital environment. Okay, so as you see, this is a new world, a new environment where our students are learning. And for me, at least, I have transformed also the time that our students are taking for different activities. And as you see, I have transformed my course to a digital world where they are doing many different things. And just to end up this this webinar, and I will be opening and giving you the floor for all the questions that you may have, I want to speak a little bit about the assessment. That the problem here is that the literature, the people that is all the day making research around the how to make assessment in digital environments is very divided, is very split. I mean, there are many different theories. We do not know yet which is the best way to make the assessment online. So, as I said before, we are facing new problems because we are not very used to the assessment part in online environments. So that's why in my case and in the case of many other professors all over the world, we have adopted a very a mixture of different assessment activities that our students are going to be developing during the semester. For example, in my case, I do weekly tests. I ask them to solve group projects. I also ask them to write a paper at the end of the semester. I also evaluate how they take part in online conversations. So I evaluate them in different dimensions because in that way I can control better if they are cheating or not. Because if they want to cheat, they must be cheating in different contexts. And that's much more complex rather than if they are only assessed with only one test. And that's why the literature always recommend to divide the assessment in different activities and to evaluate later the consistency on those different activities. Because in that way, you are going to find which student is consistent with different tests, which student is always maintaining a good grade. And in that way, we are going to diversify the risks considering the how easy could be to copy and to cheat in online environments. And that's why I recommend to you to give them also a prompt feedback, because if you are assessing with different tools, it's better if you provide them proper feedback quite fast. Encourage the active learning, I mean to the active part in any learning setting to take an active role in the different activities that we are developing. Communicate expectations. I mean, what do you expect from your students? Because in the traditional face-to-face classroom, it's very easy to communicate the expectations. You explain them the test, but what happens in an online environment where it's more difficult to communicate the expectations and it's also more difficult to understand what our professor expects and waits from us. Okay, so that's why I do evaluate in a very diversified way, and I also give them prompt feedback quite easily. And I use this kind of online rubrics, okay, where, as you see, at the start of the semester, I provide the rubric that makes more objective the assessment of my students, because I give them all the elements that I am going to consider for their evaluation. For example, the relevance of the message that they write. For example, how they express themselves in a post and how they contribute to the community learning. I mean, I provide them the different indicators, the different learning outcomes that I expect from them and how I am going to evaluate them. I mean, which are the descriptors for each learning outcome that our students are supposed to develop. So this is what we call the online teaching rubric, and this is what it's called a more objective way of assessment for online settings. Okay, so keep in mind all these things that I am explaining to you. Keep in mind that in online settings is more difficult to understand your thinking. So keep in mind that you should share with your students all the elements that they need to consider. And just in case any engineering colleagues are hearing me in this session, I know that it's obviously more complicated to evaluate, for example, practical issues, procedural issues, and laboratory activities in online settings. Fortunately, many different American universities have open for free different simulators. Okay, for example, the University of Colorado has open more than 650 million online laboratories and online simulators to teach very different courses. Let's suppose that we want to teach something on physics. I guess that any of you are is on this field. Okay, and let's suppose that we want to teach, for example, something around calculus, okay, or something, we have here the simulator, or something around circuits, around electronics. Here we can download this simulator because, as I said, it has been open for free during this coronavirus outbreak, and these are interactive simulators to teach something, okay? As you see, these are laboratories where we can, as you see, this is a wire. We can put here a bulb. We can connect the wire to the bulb. You see, everything has been already invented. So you only need to spend some time trying to find on the internet the laboratory you need, because many universities are helping other ones over the world, opening simulators, opening laboratories, opening practical issues, because I am teacher on engineering, so I know that this is we are struggling to teach as if we were in class. So that's why I think these are interesting resources for you, and that's why I wanted also to share with you. And finally, I am going to speak about the last three elements regarding the assessment part, because I know that you may be worried about how difficult it is to, for example, distribute the exam, because what happens if our exam ends up in the wrong hands, for example, in someone that can solve the exam for our students. So for that sense, we do have some tools such as Genius Scan or Gradescope that permits you to distribute any PDF in a secure way. And we also have some tools such as the browser lockers that lock up the browser where our student is, in the way that they are not going to be able to open a new tab or to open a new application. They are only going to be able to have the browser with the questionnaire or the exam and to solve all the elements in that browser. They are going to have everything locked up, and they are only going to be able to answer to the things that they have in front of their eyes. Okay, so take a look to these browser lockers, okay, because they are very very valid for many of the issues that you may be facing. And some of them, again, have been open for free for this coronavirus outbreak that we are facing. And finally, the proctoring tools. I know that this is a very sensitive issue, okay, because you know that the proctoring tools are those webcams that are all the time scanning up the face of the person that is on the other side of the exam, for example. So these tools would be all the time recording the face of your students in the way that they will be ensuring that the person that is in the other side of the computer is all the time the same one. So it's kind of a tool to assess and to ensure that the same person is at the other side of the computer all the time, just to check that that student has received the exam and has given the computer to, for example, to her dad or to her mom, okay? In the way that it's, it could be otherwise quite complicated to check if that person is all the time the same. Okay, so proctoring tools are also available for us. They provide us these authentication tools that has been also open for free in some cases. So here I provide you some resources on it. Just you to check them up and to improve the tools that you use to evaluate your students. Okay. So just to end up, I have less. I have just left here for you some of the references, some of the scientific articles that I have been reading during these last years, in order to learn from myself in these online environments. So I strongly recommend to you to take a look to all these resources, because there are plenty of authors writing about how to improve the quality of our teaching in online environments. And some of the articles that I have provided you before have been taken from these websites where we do have a huge amount of literature available for us to improve the quality that at the end, I think, is our objective. To be also good professors, as if we are in the traditional face-to-face sessions. So I think here that you are going to find interesting resources. So thank you so much again. It has been my pleasure to be here with you today. And I give the floor back to my colleague, Ivan Dukarev. Sorry for my Russian pronunciation, but I thank you once again for your time. And I thank you once again in the name of the University of Deusto for your trust and for your collaboration during this last years. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alex, for this very interesting and timely presentation. I think many of universities faced these problems. And just for you, information for you, that we have already organized such webinars in Southeast Asia, in Africa, and in Latin America, and always we met a lot of interest and a lot of questions. So we have several questions here online. I have some questions which are frequently asked questions from other webinars, and I will ask Alex to respond to them. But first, I would like to ask some questions that we received here. For example, from Yelena Mirsalieva, she's asking Alex how to keep professors motivated, because a lot of professors are used for the traditional way of teaching, and many universities faced also problem how to motivate not only to students but also professors to move to online teaching.
Okay, thank you, Ivan, and thank you for the question. I think that's one of the main challenges. You may remember that I have said during my presentation that we should also focus on the motivation of the professors, and at least from our experience, there are two very basic tools, but that they work very well. The first one is to help them out with workshops, with training. Okay. Our professors haven't been trained to teach online, so we need to teach them online during these times. And the second one is to offer them those group work spaces, such as social networks, where they can share their problems, where they can learn from others, and where they can find kind of a social space to know that they are not alone, to know that other ones are as they are, and that we are a community that is trying to help our universities at the same time.
Okay, thank you. Alex, also another questions and our comments, that is, of course, the disciplines like social sciences, medicine, engineering, natural sciences, as you told, need a support for lab activities. And for example, for natural science is a big problem, a final thesis defense or even a final assessment. So it was question of Anna Borodina. So how to organize, for example, thesis defenses in this environment?
We have already done three PhD defenses, dissertations online, and I think for me it's one of the easiest assessment parts, because you first of all need to control the identity of the person that is on the other side of the computer. Secondly, you need to build up a meeting such as this one, where the professors are hearing someone that is presenting his or her screen, and a tool that also permits you to see the face of the person that is presenting, such as this one. In Google Meet, you are not only seeing my slides, you are seeing my screen, my face. So you can also check up that the person is all the time being the same one. Okay, so at least for me, it's a combination of video conferencing tools combined with this identity control tools that I have explained at the last part of the webinar. And apart from that, regarding the laboratories, I strongly agree with our colleague, because we are having difficult times for that. So please take a look to those simulators, because there are plenty of them available at the internet to help you out during these days.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Alex. I think we have no more questions. And of course, we will send this presentation, the presentation as a PowerPoint presentation, and this video recording to you. And it will come with a feedback form. It is very important that you reply with your feedback, not only just giving your opinion about this webinar, but also giving us opinion, asking questions if any. So we will reply to you by email, and also giving any idea of the webinars that you probably need in a greater detail in one or another theme. So I thank you, Alex, for your presentation. I thank you, everybody, for your participation and your interest. And I wish you to stay healthy and safe, and to stay in contact all together. So,
Spasiba to all you, and please, Ivan, say some Russian words to say goodbye from myself to all our colleagues, and looking forward to meet all you.
Yes, I also want to say thank you for Erasmus Plus office in Russia, for Olga Leynikova, Anna Viktorova, for their personal support of this event, and for my colleagues Sara Gotia and Paula Sanchez for the technical support of this organizational technical support of this webinar. So thank you very much, and hope to see you soon somehow in online or in real environment. Thank you very much. Our webinar is closed.